Hello, did you know that in biblical thinking, name equals authority, but name also equals fame? So, by obscuring the name of the Creator, Satan attempts to interfere with the Creator's authority, and Satan attempts to interfere with the Creator's fame. Let me show you. Jews have replaced the name of the Creator with Adonai, and even Hashem, while Christians have replaced the Creator's name with Lord. And how about Pan, Zoti, Her, Uram, Shoda Probu in other languages? Can you see the confusion? Do you see the interference? Therefore, in this video series, we will focus on the original Hebrew name of the Creator, Yod-Heh-Wah-Heh. Numerous topics and arguments will be investigated and tested against authentic Hebrew manuscript evidence. Thanks to Justin, my son, who prepared these topics and who will also be presenting these topics. My name is Pete van Rensburg. Please visit us at HebrewGospels.com.
Hello everyone and welcome back to the series on the Nehemiah Gordon and the pronunciation of the Tetragrammaton Yod-Heh-Wah-Heh. This is session number 11. Did the Hebrew vowel points originate from Moses, or were they invented by the scribes in the Middle Ages to capture the traditional reading of the Hebrew Bible? Why is this an important question when it comes to the name Yod-Heh-Wah-Heh and its pronunciation? What I've been showing you so far through this series is that, yes, the consonants of the name Yod-Heh-Wah-Heh are part of the original Bible. Even though some of the books were written in the Paleo-Hebrew script, it's the same language, and the name Yod-Heh-Wah-Heh is part of the Bible, but the vowels, the blue vowel points you see here on the screen, were only added after the name was banned from being pronounced and replaced with Adonai. And after they replaced the name with Adonai, then the scribes added the traditional vowel points to the Hebrew Bible, and so they put Adonai's vowels on the name because that's what they pronounced when they saw the name Yod-Heh-Wah-Heh. On the other hand, Nehemiah Gordon teaches that these vowel points on the name preserve the original pronunciation of the name Yehovah, not the traditional pronunciation of the name Adonai. And this is based on the supposition that the vowel points are original rather than traditional. Also, in the previous two videos, we talked about the 10 rabbis, and we saw that this whole misunderstanding of the Creator's name supposedly being Yehovah, or Yehovah as these rabbis say, is based on the misunderstanding that the vowel points supposedly come from Moses. And not only do some rabbis believe that the vowel points come from Moses, some Karaites also believe this. Let's start with the famous quote by the Karaite Yehuda Hadasi. And he said, "They, the Torah scrolls, must be pointed with vowels and accents, for our Elohim did not give them without vowels and accents. The writing of our Elohim was engraved on the tables. Thus they were complete in their writing, with vowels and accents, and they did not lack any of their vowels or accents." Very bold claim by this Karaite. Let's look at some of these phrases in Hebrew. Belo nikud veta'amim lo netanam Elohenu. Our Elohim did not give them without vowels and accents. Kacha hayu mele'im bichtivatan benikud veta'amim. Thus they were complete in their writing, with vowels and accents. Now, although Nehemiah Gordon is careful not to openly express his view on the vowel points, remember that every time when Nehemiah Gordon says the name is Yehovah, and every time when he pronounces the name as Yehovah, this is based on the supposition that the vowel points are original, just like this Karaite Hadasi said. They're not the traditional vowels recorded in the Middle Ages, they're the original vowels of the Hebrew Bible. Is this true? When Nehemiah was asked, when were the vowels added to the Hebrew Bible, this is what he said. Traditional Jewish sources debate about when the vowels were first written down. Some say at the time of Adam, some say at the time of Moses, some say at the time of Ezra, and then others say around the year 600 CE, at the time of the Masoretes in the Middle Ages, the scribes invented these vowel points. And then Nehemiah adds this comment, first suggested in 1538. Nehemiah makes the claim that before the 16th century, all the Jewish sources agreed that the vowel points are either from Adam, Moses, or Ezra. And only in the 16th century did someone come up with this new idea that the scribes invented the vowel points. Is this true? Let's move on to a video clip of Nehemiah Gordon in his study, Jaw-Dropping Revelations from Israel. And he talks about the vowel points, and he makes the claim that Yeshua's words testify to this cholam on the name Yod-Heh-Vav-Heh, and that Yeshua's words testify to the authenticity of the vowel points.
So in the Hebrew version of Matthew, it says, Ot v'nukuda, I have not come, he said, one letter and one vowel will not pass away from the Torah until all is fulfilled. That's what it says in the Hebrew version of Matthew, one consonant or one vowel. Now.
Wow.
And I said, Yeshua spoke the words here, and it was right over there within visual shot, within eye, you know, you could see where his words were fulfilled. That is, the scribes, they had this policy to remove one of those vowels, to remove one of the vowels, and what happened is they couldn't remove it in every place. The vowel was preserved. He spoke the words here and over there. His words actually came to pass.
Yes.
That one jot or one tittle, yes, one consonant, one vowel wouldn't pass away from this Torah. And every time we see that missing vowel not missing, Yeshua's words testify to that.
That's right.
And the words were spoken there, and then they came to pass there. And today we can sit and study these manuscripts,
yes,
and see that not one dot has passed away from the Torah. That dot that preserves the pronunciation of the name of the creator of the universe is still there.
So, firstly, why is this cholam often missing from the name Yod-Heh-Vav-Heh? Go back to video number 5. This cholam on the name Yod-Heh-Vav-Heh is often missing not to hide the true pronunciation from us, but because the scribes put dummy vowels on the name, the vowels of Adonai. For example, in the Aleppo Codex, Adonai is written without a cholam. That's how Aaron ben Asher pointed the word Adonai. Only in rare occasions did he slip up and put in the O, the cholam of Adonai. So what do you think happened when Aaron ben Asher put the vowels of Adonai on the name? Normally, there's no cholam. But once in a while, he slips up and he puts in the O of Adonai. And we covered this in great detail in video number 5. Secondly, is it true that Yeshua's words testify to the authenticity of the vowel points? Did the Hebrew vowel points exist in the first century? Are they part of the inspired text of the Torah? Not one of these vowels will pass away. Yes or no? Today, we want to talk about 4 main topics that will answer this question. Number 1, we're going to look at Jewish sources which deny that the vowel points are from Moses. Is it true that before the 16th century, all the Jewish sources agreed that the vowel points either come from Adam, Ezra, or Moses, or not? Number 2, we're going to talk about lies in the name of Moses, and we'll see that when Jewish teachers need to invoke Moses to give themselves authority, they are very often telling lies and not the truth. Number 3, we will look at factual evidence that the vowel points are not from Moses. And number 4, clear evidence that the vowel points are not from Ezra. And between all of this, we'll see many indications that the vowel points did not exist in the first century at the time of Yeshua. So, let's start with number 1, Jewish sources which deny that the vowel points are from Moses. Let's have a look at this video clip of Nehemiah Gordon and Keith Johnson, where they talk about the origin of the Hebrew vowel points.
When were the vowels added to the Hebrew Bible? That's simple question, but boy, oh boy.
It's a really important question. Yes. Before I get to the answer, I want to explain that there were different opinions within Jewish sources about this question.
Mm-hmm.
And I mean traditional Jewish sources. So up until the 16th century, and specifically 1538, there was a rabbi named Eliyahu Bachur. Up until that rabbi, there were three main opinions about when the vowels were written down mm-hmm. into the Hebrew Bible.
Mm-hmm.
The first opinion, which seems a bit extreme, but there were rabbis who believed that the vowels were written in the Hebrew Bible in the time of Adam.
Okay,
that's fine, whatever. The more serious opinions were divided between Moses writing the vowels down and Ezra writing the vowels down. These are the traditional Jewish opinions mm-hmm. about when the vowels were written down. Ezra seems to have been the more dominant position, as far as I can tell, in Jewish source, mm-hmm. traditional Jewish sources. Then in 1538, there was a rabbi in the Renaissance.
Mm-hmm.
And in the Renaissance, people started to get skeptical. Mm-hmm. And they started to question this sort of thing. And so this rabbi Eliyahu Bachur comes along, and he argues that, no, the vowels were, look, he says, okay, the vowels were fixed from a very early period, but they weren't written down with graphic symbols until around the year 600 AD.
Okay, so it is pretty clear what Nehemiah Gordon teaches. He teaches that up until the 1600s, all the Jewish sources agreed that the vowel points either come from Moses, Ezra, or Adam. Okay, just as we saw in his written article, Cutting Through the Confusion. And you know what? All three of these views, Adam, Moses, and Ezra, assume the divine inspiration of the vowel points. Because if the Hebrew vowel points existed since the time of Adam, then every author of every biblical book would have used these vowel points in his original scroll, and these points would have been part of the inspired text of the Bible. If Moses added the vowel points to the Hebrew Bible, he compiled the book of Genesis, vowel pointed it, wrote the rest of the books of the Torah, vowel pointed them as well, and after Moses, every new prophet or author of the Bible would have added the vowel points to his new book. Even if the vowel points were added by Ezra, it would mean that the vowel points are divinely inspired, just like the book of Ezra is divinely inspired and is part of the Hebrew Bible. And is it true? Is Nehemiah's claims true that only when the people became skeptical in the 16th century, they came up with this new and liberal idea that the vowel points were invented in the Middle Ages? Is this true? Let's look at earlier Jewish sources. Jewish sources before the 16th century that deny that the vowel points are from Moses. So the first quote we'll be looking at is actually from the Zohar. And before we read this quote, let's just remind ourselves, what is the Zohar? We talked about this in video number 9 in some detail. The Zohar is the Bible of Jewish occultism or mysticism called Kabbalah. It is a blasphemous book. It is a fraudulent book. It was invented as a forgery in the 13th century, and it pretends to have been written in the 2nd century. And so many people will quote the Zohar and say, see, this proves the vowel points existed back in the 1st century. How can a 13th century forgery prove what existed in the 1st century? Doesn't make sense. What does the Zohar prove? The Zohar shows us what the mystics believed in the 13th century, and the Zohar also shows us that there were opponents. There were people in the 13th century who did not accept the mystic interpretations on the Bible and who did not believe that the vowel points are from Moses. Let's read this quote. These points came forth from the secret mind, meaning that supposedly these vowel points are divinely inspired to establish the consonants in their order. And if you say the scribes instituted the points, hush and quiet. You're not allowed to say that. Why is there any need for the Zohar to say, if you say the scribes instituted the points, keep quiet? It's because there were people back in the 13th century who said, no, the vowel points are not part of the inspired text. The scribes instituted the vowel points. Can you see this was not suggested for the first time in the 16th century? Let's go back to the 12th century. And now we're talking about a famous rabbi called Ben Ezra or Aven Ezra. And this rabbi is really famous. For example, in the Second Rabbinic Bible, there are two sets of commentaries printed around the biblical text and the Aramaic translation. And the one is the commentary of Rabbi Rashi, and the other is the commentary of Avin Ezra. So he's a very famous rabbi. And this is what he had to say about the vowel points. He says, the sheen, the point is on the right-hand side. Now let's just pause there. In Hebrew, we have one consonant that is both a seen and a sheen. It has two pronunciations, sh as in shalom, and s as in simla, for example. And the Masoretic scribes indicated these two different pronunciations using a dot above this consonant. If the dot is on the right-hand side, it's a sheen. If it's on the left-hand side, it's a seen. And this is what this rabbi is talking about. He says, thus was the custom of the wise men of Tiberias, and they are the root, meaning they are the source. For of them were the men of the Masoret, and from them we have received all the vowels. In fact, in Hebrew it says all the Nikud. And Nikud is used in the Middle Ages to refer not only to the vowel points, but also to the other signs and dots in the Hebrew Bible. For example, the dot above the seen versus the sheen, as this rabbi makes it clear. He says that all these pointings in the Hebrew Bible come from the Tiberian Masoretes. Did he say that? He said they're from the wise men of Tiberias, and they were men of the Masoret. Masoret is handed down tradition, and that's where we get the name Masorah and Masoret. This is the Hebrew way of saying Masoretes. This rabbi says all the vowels come from the Tiberian Masoretes. Can you believe this? Back in the 12th century, long before the 16th century, this is what Rabbi Avin Ezra said. Let's go all the way back to the 10th century. And now we're talking about a Karait. And Jeffrey Kahn says, the Karait al-Kirkisani in the 10th century states that the vowels are subordinate to the letters and are not part of the Holy Script. In other words, they don't come from Ezra, they don't come from Moses, they did not exist back at the time of Adam, because otherwise they would have been part of the inspired text. This is in the 10th century, a Karait. Interestingly, the Karait who said the vowel points are from Moses lived two centuries later than the Karait who said the vowel points are not from Moses. Okay, let's go all the way back to the 9th century. And what is so significant about the 9th and 10th centuries? At this time, the scribes were still improving the vowel point system in the Hebrew Bible. We'll see clear evidence of that today. So back in the 9th and 10th centuries, it was common knowledge that the scribes invented the vowel points and that they were even still improving the vowel pointing system. And so they asked this rabbi, and he's called Rabbi Natronai Tu Ben Hilai. They asked him, can we vowel point our Torah scrolls? And this is his response. And that you asked whether it is prohibited to vowel point a Torah scroll, the Torah scroll which was given to Moses at Sinai, we have not heard that there were vowel points in it. Can you believe it? In the 9th century, this rabbi had never heard. In other words, there's no tradition back in the 9th century that Moses' Torah scroll was vowel pointed. No such tradition in the 9th century. And the vowel points were not given at Sinai, but by the wise ones to be a signal for reading. Therefore, they do not vowel point the Torah scroll. Can you see back in the 9th century, we have a rabbi saying the vowel points were not given at Sinai, but by the sages, by the wise ones. They don't refer to Moses and Ezra as the sages. Okay, so this is obviously past Ezra. Otherwise, he would have said the men of the great synagogue if he was referring to Ezra. But it's rather obvious he's referring to the sages or the wise ones after the time of Ezra. Otherwise, these vowel points, like I said, would have been part of the inspired text if they came from Ezra. Let's look at some phrases here in the Hebrew. Lo shamanu bo nikud. We have not heard in it a vowel point. Meaning we have not heard that there were vowel points in it, in the Torah scroll which Moses received. Velo nitan nikud besinai. And the nikud, the pointings, were not given at Sinai. Okay, so is it true that the medieval Masoretic origin of the vowel points was only suggested in the 16th century? Is it true that before the 16th century, all the Jews agreed that the vowel points either come from Adam or Moses or Ezra? Is that true or is that untrue? Did Nehemiah never do his research? Or is he purposefully misrepresenting the information? What is the problem? Let's move on to point number two. Lies in the name of Moses and Sinai. We will see that when Jewish teachers say, oh, that comes from Moses, oh, that comes from Sinai, you can't assume it's true. Rather, it's a warning saying, watch out, this is most likely untrue. Let's start with a video clip of Nehemiah Gordon, where he talks about one of the 10 rabbis.
This is what it says in chapter 34, concerning the Tetragrammaton. Its vowels received from Sinai are Shva, Olam, Kamatz.
So, why is Nehemiah Gordon so excited about this rabbi saying the vowels received from Sinai are Shva, Olam, Kamatz, if he does not believe that the vowel points come from Sinai? It seems Nehemiah Gordon really likes the idea that these Hebrew vowel points come from Sinai. Also, as we covered in video number 9 in some detail, this rabbi did not say the Tetragrammaton's vowels are Shva, Olam, Kamatz. He said the vowels of Adonai received from Sinai are Shva, Olam, Kamatz. But we covered that in video number 9. For today, we're interested in this phrase, received from Sinai. What does it mean when Jewish teachers say, oh, this was received from Sinai. Oh, that's a law of Moses from Sinai. We're going to look at clear examples of Jewish teachers who lied in the name of Moses. Let's start with one about the vowel points. It is true that the points were given at Sinai, but they forgot them until Ezra came and revealed them. Now, how likely is this? Do you really think it's possible? Moses wrote the Torah, okay? And then they copied the Torah meticulously to this day, but they forgot all of the vowel points until Ezra came and revealed them. Is this true, or is this a lie in the name of Moses? Some Jewish teachers claim that the rules of the accents come from Moses. Look at this one. There are some punctuators who ask, why do we not make two zarkot or two zarkas, which are a particular kind of accent, on one word? But if they had known that there is never more than one zarka, meaning per verse, and that nothing was revealed to our teacher Moses of blessed memory except one zarka followed by segol, meaning segolta, they would not have made a difficulty about this. So this teacher did not know what to say. So he invoked Moses and said, no, this comes from Moses. You certainly don't want to argue with Moses. Is it true that these rules come from Moses? Let's go to the Torah and we'll see that even if Moses wrote the vowel points and accents into the Bible, this Jewish teacher just lied to us in the name of Moses, because here we have two zarkas in a row in one verse, only then followed by segulta. It's not a mistake. This is how the scribes accentuated some verses in the Hebrew Bible with two zarkas. This is the shape of the zarka in old manuscripts or in older manuscripts. In some of the late manuscripts, they have a different shape. But very clearly, we have two zarkas in a row, only then followed by segulta. Here's another example from the Torah. Two zarkot or two zarkas, only then followed by segulta. Even in the Aleppo Codex, although most of the Torah is missing and we can't check in the Torah, in the book of Joshua we find two zarkas, only then followed by segulta. So this Jewish teacher very clearly told a lie in the name of Moses. He invoked Moses, saying there's never more than one zarka followed by segulta. And clearly there are often two zarkas followed by segulta. So often these Jewish teachers invoked Moses when they couldn't think of a good answer. And unfortunately, they often lied in the name of Moses. Look at this one. The square script is from Moses from Sinai. Really? Rabbi says, the Torah was first given Ashurit, meaning in square characters, but when they sinned, it was changed by them to Ratz, meaning Paleo-Hebrew script. Why did the rabbis say that? Here's another example. Rabbi says, The Torah was first given, meaning at Sinai from Moses, first given in this square script. When they sinned, it was changed by them to Ro'at Sora'at, which means the paleo Hebrew script. And when they repented, the square script was returned to them. Why did the rabbis say this? Because in the Talmudic era, the Jews used the square script. But their enemies, the Samaritans, were still using a kind of paleo-Hebrew script. And so they didn't like the idea that the Samaritans are using the original script and they are using the second-hand script. So they made a plan. They say, no, you know why the Samaritans use paleo-Hebrew? It's because they sinned. Why did they never change back to the original square characters? Because they never repented. They're really just condemning their enemies and making themselves look good. We all know today that from inscriptions and even the oldest copy of a verse of the Hebrew Bible, we'll talk about that later today, in the first temple period and earlier they used paleo-Hebrew script. There's no indication that the original Torah was written in block letters. This is another lie in the name of Moses and Sinai. How about this one? The five final letters are a law of Moses from Sinai. It was said by Rabbi Matthew ben Charash that Mantzapach is a halacha or a law of Moses from Sinai. What is Mantzapach? These are the five letters that in the square script take a special final form at the end of a word. Let's look at this quote. Rabbi Shimon said in the name of Rabbi Yehoshua ben Levi that Mantzapach is a halacha of Moses from Sinai. How could this be true? In Paleo-Hebrew, they don't even use these five final letters like they use them in the block script. How could this come from Moses from Sinai? They're invoking Moses because they realize that they don't have, you know, authority for what they're doing. This is not original. This is something that the scribes invented, or this is a new system that they adopted. And so they invoke Moses to give themselves authority. Ketiv lo kerei and kerei lo ketiv are a law of Moses from Sinai. Did you know there are certain letters that are written into the Hebrew Bible, which by tradition are not read? And then there are other words and letters that are not written into the Bible, and by tradition they still read these words and letters as if they are there in the biblical text. This is called Ketiv lo kerei and kerei lo ketiv. Rabbi Yitzchak said, words that are read but not written, and words written but not read, are all a halacha, a law, of Moses from Sinai. Okay, how could this be true? Did you know some of these cases where they read a word that is not written in the text occur outside the Torah? Moses only wrote the Torah, not the whole Tanakh. He did not write the whole Old Testament. So how could Moses be responsible for every ketiv lo kerei and kerei lo ketiv in the whole Tanakh? Is that possible? Or is this impossible? Is this true? Or is this another lie in the name of Moses? Every ketiv kerei is a law of Moses from Sinai? Really? Every word which is kerei and ketiv is a halacha of Moses from Sinai. So remember, what is ketiv kerei? It's where the traditional pronunciation contradicts the written text and they read words differently than the way they're written. And this comes from Moses from Sinai. And again, many of these ketiv kereis occur outside the Torah. How could Moses be responsible for every ketiv kerei in the whole Tanakh? This is a lie in the name of Moses. Verse divisions are supposedly from Moses. A verse which Moses did not divide, we may not divide. And again, how could Moses be responsible for every verse division in the whole Tanakh if he only wrote down the Torah? It's fairly impossible. Now this gets really serious. The Talmud and Mishnah, the oral law, is from Moses from Sinai. Really? Remember, when Yeshua came to earth, he perfectly upheld the original Torah as given to Moses at Sinai. But Yeshua did not keep and obey the man-made traditions, the traditions of the elders. Yeshua would heal on the Sabbath. Yeshua made clay on the Sabbath. Yeshua commanded the lame man, take up your bed and walk on the Sabbath. All of this defies the man-made traditions as recorded by the Talmud. And yet there are Jewish teachers who claim that the Talmud comes from Moses. What is the meaning of Exodus 24:12? Tables are the 10 words or the 10 commandments. And the commandment is the Mishnah. To teach them is the Talmud, teaching us that all of them were given to Moses from Sinai. Is this true, or is this a lie in the name of Moses? How about this one? What rabbis answer their students are from Moses from Sinai? Really? When the Holy One, blessed be He, revealed Himself at Sinai, even that which a student asks the Rav, the Rabbi, the Holy One, blessed be He, told to Moses at that time. Can you believe it? When you go to synagogue or you ask your rabbi a question, the answer comes from Moses from Sinai, because your question was already told to Moses at Sinai. Can you believe that? This is just the rabbis saying, we have all the authority and you don't argue with us. This is a lie in the name of Moses. So what we've seen so far is when Jewish teachers need to invoke Moses to give themselves authority or to make their argument look good and look true, they are most likely lying to you. For example, this rabbi is saying the vowels of Adonai received from Sinai are Shua, Chol, and Kametz. He's most likely not speaking the truth, because why does he need to invoke Moses? Let's move on to number 3, clear evidence that the vowel points are not from Moses. Clear evidence that these Jewish teachers who invoke Moses and say the vowel points are from Moses are lying to us. To answer this question about the vowel points, we're going to look at 8 clear evidences that the vowel points are not from Moses. Number 1, there are no Masoretic vowel points in Paleo-Hebrew. Number 2, the Masada scrolls from the first century have no vowel points. Number 3, we're going to talk about evidence from the Talmud. We'll talk about the oldest vowel-pointed manuscripts, which are from the 6th and 7th centuries. There are 3 systems of vowel pointing, and these systems were improved over hundreds of years in the Middle Ages. And then we'll also talk about 2 special kinds of Ketiv Kareh, which clearly show that Moses did not add the vowel points to the Hebrew Bible. So let's start with number 1, no Masoretic vowel points in Paleo-Hebrew. This is common knowledge. When we look at Paleo-Hebrew inscriptions or letters like the Lachish letters, we can see the Hebrew language, we can see the Paleo-Hebrew script, we see no vowel points. Let's just zoom in. What's really interesting about this, these Lachish letters, is that the name Yod-Heh is used. There you can see Yod-Heh, and again down here Yod-Heh. Back then in the first temple period, they still used the name in everyday speech. The name was not yet banned, and this is what makes these letters so interesting. Let's just zoom in. You can clearly see the name Yod-Heh, and there are no vowel points. In case you can't see properly, here's a black and white picture. You can see the letters, you can see the name Yod-Heh, no vowel points. There are some dots here. These are like spaces separating words from each other, and we'll talk more about them later today. But there are no vowel points here. And what do people say? People might say, we never said that the Lachish letters were vowel pointed. This is not the Torah which Moses received from Sinai, is it? You see, the claim is that the original Torah received by Moses at Sinai was vowel pointed. And that's why we need to talk about the oldest remaining copy of a verse of the Torah contained in the silver scrolls. So we're very interested in these silver scrolls, and in particular we'll look at scroll number 2, the little scroll there on the left hand side. And these scrolls are from the 7th century BCE, and they're really tiny, the small scroll. is a little bit more than a centimeter wide, and it's a couple centimeters long. And these two scrolls contain the oldest known copy of a Bible verse. And this is a verse from the Torah. On the left-hand side, you can see a zoomed photograph, and then a black and white picture in the middle, and then the block letter transcription on the right-hand side. And let's just read part of this. The Bible verse starts there with a yod, Yevarech Yodewahei Yishmerecha. May Yodewahei bless and keep you. Ya'eir Yodhei Wahei Panau Eilecha. May Yodewahei cause his face to shine upon you. Ve'yaseim Lecha Shalom. And give you peace. This is part of the priestly blessing which we find in the book of Numbers in the Torah. So this is the oldest example of a verse from the Torah that exists today that we know of. And yet, there are no vowel points in it. No vowel points. And the scribe who wrote the letters into the scroll was really meticulous. He had to write these tiny little letters into the silver scroll. Remember, this was jewelry. Okay, jewelry. In the 7th century BCE. And we can see how meticulous the scribe was by looking at these strokes next to the name Yodewahei. And why did the scribe add these lines into the scroll? And we can also see them in the black and white picture over there and over there. And again in the photo, we can see these little lines. These are not consonants. They're not vowels. They're not accents. What are they doing in the text? Well, you see, let's look at the block letter transcript. The name Yodewahei did not fit into this line. And they had to break it off and write half the name on the next line. Yodhei, Wahei. But now we have a problem because the special name Yodewahei could be confused with the words around it. How do you know this is not Ya'eriya, as in Alleluia? I mean, you could make a mistake by mixing up these consonants with the word next to it, or these consonants with the word next to it. And so the scribe made a plan, and he added these little strokes into the text, separating the name Yod-Hei-Wau-Hei from the words surrounding it. So this scribe was so meticulous, why did he not add the vowel points received from Moses from Sinai into this manuscript, into this little silver scroll? Because there were no vowels received from Moses from Sinai. Certainly a scribe taking so much care, if he believed that the vowel points were part of the inspired text, he would have added them into the scroll. This is quite undeniable, very clear evidence that the original Torah did not have vowel points, and that the official Torah back in the 7th century BCE did not have vowel points either. Let's move on to evidence number two, the Masada scrolls from the 1st century CE. And let's first of all talk about the Qumran scrolls, the Dead Sea Scrolls, but in particular the Qumran scrolls. It's well known that these scrolls don't use vowel points. The scribes who wrote them did not add vowel points to these scrolls. However, what we see in the Qumran scrolls is they used vowel letters. Each of these arrows indicates a vowel letter in this great Isaiah scroll that is not found in the Masoretic text. So these are extra letters added to the text to assist in the pronunciation of these words. The first vowel letter shown here is an aleph. Some say it shows the preceding yod is a vowel letter and this is wahi. Others say this indicates ah and this is kiya. In either way, it's a vowel letter. Then we have a wow there indicating the O of Tomeru. This word is Tomeru. And then this final wow, of course, indicates the U. So interestingly, none of these vowel letters indicate exactly what vowel is to be pronounced. Because the Aleph can be an A or an E. The wow can be an O or an U. And even the He, here we see Hua. This He most likely indicates an A. But in some words, the vowel letter he is part of the vowel segol, e, and in some words, the vowel letter he is even part of the vowel o. So none of these vowel letters indicate exactly how to pronounce the text. You need to know the language, and then these vowel letters help you to pronounce the text correctly. correctly. Also, we see these dots above the word Birushalayim. Now, it's rather obvious that you can't have the same vowel point on each of these letters. These are not vowel points. These are scribal erasure dots, and we'll talk more about them in just a minute. But now, what do people say? I mean, it's pretty clear. These scrolls written 2nd century BCE, they don't have vowel points. People say, well, the people at Qumran rejected the authority of the temple. That's what Nehemiah says. He's negative toward the people at Qumran. The Essenes, they rejected the authority of the temple. Of course, they would not have written the vowel points into their manuscripts. You see, it's the claim of some people, and even Nehemiah purports that it is so, that the temple scroll in the first century was vowel pointed. Let's look at this short video clip of Nehemiah Gordon, where he talks about the temple scroll and how that not one of the vowels have passed away.
So around the year 250, give or take, the Bible is returned. The temple courtyard manuscript is returned to Beit Ma'on. The temple courtyard manuscript is returned to Beit Ma'on, which is in Upper Tiberias today. And then around the year 600 is when we have the name of the first Masoretes who start to copy that Bible. And maybe it started to wither and needed to be copied before it was lost.
Right.
And so from around the year 600, they start to copy it. So all of this is happening in this place and over periods of hundreds of years. And the words were spoken there, and then they came to pass there. And today we can sit and study these manuscripts and see that not one dot has passed away from the Torah. That dot that preserves the pronunciation of the name of the creator of the universe is still there.
Okay, so it's the claim of Nehemiah Gordon that this temple courtyard manuscript, also called the temple court manuscript, is the manuscript copied by the Masoretes. Now that's possible, but Nehemiah makes the claim that not one dot has passed away since the time of Yeshua until the time of the Masoretes, meaning that this temple scroll at the time of Yeshua was vowel-pointed and the Masoretes simply copied these vowels into their manuscripts. However, this is not true at all when we look at the first century copies of the temple scroll. We actually have remnants of fragments of these scrolls from the first century. For example, this Masada scroll containing some of the Psalms. This is Psalm 82. We can still read most of the words here. We can see Mizmor, Le'asaf, the Resh is missing there. And this is Elohim, Nitzav, Ba'adat, El, Bekerav, Elohim, Yishpot. Can you see none of the words have vowel points on them? So it's quite clear here that these scrolls from the first century contain no vowel points. And yet the experts in textual transmission of the Old Testament tell us that these scrolls were copied from the temple court manuscript, as we see in this quote, fragments found in Masada from the 1st century CE, and then some other scrolls. According to Professor Emmanuel Tov, these texts from communities outside Qumran constitute an inner circle of proto-Masoretic texts that derived directly from temple circles and were copied from the master copy in the temple court. So we don't have to guess, did the temple court manuscript have vowels or did it not have vowels? We don't need to guess. We have clear evidence from the first century copies of the temple scroll. When we look at these copies, there are no vowel points. Here you can see Psalm 85 and we see Ratzita Yodevahei Artzecha. Yodevahei has no vowel points. There's no single dot on the name Yodevahei here. There's no vowel points on any of the words in these scrolls. So they didn't use the vowel points back in the first century in the temple court manuscript and in the copies from the temple court manuscript. So let's just go back to this video clip of Nehemiah Gordon. Where does he get the idea that Yeshua spoke about the vowel points if the vowel points did not even exist back in the first century?
So in the Hebrew version of Matthew, it says, Ot v'nukuda. I have not come, he said, one letter and one vowel will not pass away from the Torah until all is fulfilled. That's what it says in the Hebrew version of Matthew, one consonant or one vowel. Now,
wow.
And I said, Yeshua spoke the words here, and it was right over there within visual shot, within eye, you know, you could see where his words were fulfilled. That is, the scribes, they had this policy to remove one of those vowels, to remove one of the vowels, and And what happened is they couldn't remove it in every place. The vowel was preserved. He spoke the words here and over there. His words actually came to pass.
Yes.
That one jot or one tittle, yes, one consonant, one vowel wouldn't pass away from this Torah. And every time we see that missing vowel not missing, Yeshua's words testify to that.
That's right.
And the words were spoken there, and then they came to pass there. And today we can sit and study these manuscripts,
yes,
and see that not one dot has passed away from the Torah. That dot that preserves the pronunciation of the name of the creator of the universe is still there.
So can you believe how that Nehemiah Gordon misrepresents what Yeshua actually said? And he purports that Yeshua spoke about the vowel points, and yet there were no vowel points in the first century scrolls. The vowel points in the Masoretic text were not preserved since the first century. There were no vowel points in these scrolls in the first century. And so why does Nehemiah Gordon mention Yeshua, whom he does not believe in, whom he rejects? It's to make you believers in Yeshua think that Nehemiah Gordon is right, and to make you think that Yeshua prophesied about this Cholam that Nehemiah supposedly discovered. And this is not true at all. So let's talk about what did Yeshua actually say and what did he actually mean. So first of all, I want to show you what did Yeshua say based on the Vatican Hebraica 100 manuscript, which is the manuscript that we're working on at Hebrew Gospels. According to this manuscript, Yeshua did not say one jot and one tittle. Let's read this. Ani omer lachem be'emet, I say unto you in truth, shelo yechsar davar echad mehatorah, that not one word will be diminished, not one word will be lacking from the Torah. Now this makes very good sense when you look at manuscripts, because when we compare the manuscripts from the first century with the manuscripts we have today in the Masoretic text, they are very, very similar. And the only differences that we find is normally a vowel letter here and there. And these vowel letters simply assist in the pronunciation of the words. They don't necessarily change the meaning. And so a yod, a jot and a tittle, a yod is a vowel letter that sometimes comes and goes. So this reading here, that not one word will pass away from the Torah, makes perfect sense when we compare this with the history of the biblical text and how it was preserved over the ages. Now, if the Shem Tov reading, which Nehemiah refers to, is the original reading, what did Yeshua mean? And I say if, because remember, the Shem Tov, Matthew, is purposefully corrupted. I know very well that every manuscript has a mistake in it because all scribes make mistakes, but that's not what we're talking about. Someone who copied this manuscript, which Shem Tov used, deleted every instance in which Yeshua is called the Messiah by Matthew, the author. You see, it was okay to them if the demons call Yeshua the Messiah, or if Peter calls Yeshua the Messiah, but they wouldn't let Matthew call Yeshua the Messiah, because they wanted people to read this Gospel of Matthew and think, oh, even the author didn't say he's the Messiah. Something else is in the best manuscripts, which is this one and another one copied from it, the manuscripts that best preserve the Shem Tov tradition, we find places in which the text really mocks at Yeshua. They perverted the text to make fun of Yeshua. For example, where the centurion says to Yeshua, Lord, I'm not worthy that you come into my house. Guess what the Shem Tov says in the best manuscripts? It says, Lord, you're not worthy to come into my house. This is not a mistake that could come about, you know, by chance. You're not going to make that mistake without realizing it. This is a purposeful corruption of the text. And that's why I don't always trust the readings we have in the Shem Tov Matthew as being the original. But let's read this anyway. Al tachshevu shebati lehafer Torah. Don't think that I came to destroy Torah. Ela lehashlim. However, I came, is understood there, to fulfill. Be'emet ani omer lachem, in truth I say to you, ki ad shamayim va'aretz, that as long as the heavens and the earth remain, ot achat v'nekuda achat lo tivtal mehatorah, not one letter and one nekuda will pass away from the Torah. What does Nekuda mean? What did it mean in the first century? That's the word Nehemiah just translates as a vowel. Does it mean vowel point? Let's start by looking at a dictionary. This Hebrew dictionary says that Nekuda means number one, point or stud. So the first meaning is not vowel. What's the secondary meaning? Secondly, in post-biblical Hebrew, it means dot. Now keep in mind that documents written in the first century would be seen as post-biblical Hebrew because it means post-Tanakh Hebrew, Hebrew after the Old Testament. Okay? Number three, in medieval Hebrew, it means vowel point or vowel because only in the Middle Ages did they start using points as vowels. And then in the New Hebrew, it means punctuation mark. So just by looking at this dictionary, you'll think that Yeshua said dot, not vowel point. There's no indication so far that Yeshua referred to the vowel point. So what are these dots that Yeshua referred to if the Shem Tov preserves the original reading? What are these dots? Well, if Yeshua was speaking about the original Torah, which Moses wrote, there are dots that are used in Paleo-Hebrew. We see these in inscriptions, in Paleo-Hebrew inscriptions. We have these dots between the words, and they're like spaces between the words. Can you see there's a dot there, there's one there, one there, one there. And so they don't always put spaces between the words in Paleo-Hebrew, but they put these dots in between the words so you won't get confused between the different words and their consonants. Here's a black and white inverse image, so you can clearly see these dots. Here's another example of Paleo-Hebrew with nekudot, dots, between the words. And these dots are not vowel points, they're not accents, they're like spaces between these different words. And these can actually change the meaning of a sentence. Let's look at the last two words in the second last line. It says, Levet Yorewahei, to the house or for the house of Yorewahei. There's no nekuda between these two words. Why? Because the house of Yorewahei is like one word in Hebrew. In English, we often say the temple. It's not for the house, and then Yorewahei is a separate word. This is for the house of Yorewahei, as if it's one word or one concept. And so these nekudot can change the meaning of a sentence, and also they avoid confusion between different words. So if Yeshua was talking about the original Torah, written in Paleo-Hebrew, and if Yeshua actually said, not one nekuda will pass away, it means these words are not going to be confused. Because now in the block letter system, they use spaces instead of these dots. Okay, what if Yeshua was talking about the current system, which they used even before the first century, the block letters, the square script? Even in these manuscripts written in block letters, we find dots. Remember, this great Isaiah scroll is from the 2nd century BCE, and we see these dots, and we talked about this in video number 3, how that they use these to mark a word as a mistake. These are scribal erasure dots, and they were in use even prior to the 1st century CE. And what's interesting is that the official Hebrew Bible to this day have 15 words that are permanently marked with these scribal dots. These are the scribal dots that existed even before the first century. And by the way, Nehemiah knows this very well. Nehemiah talks about these scribal dots in his study called The Mistake That Got It Right, Part 2. He shows this example from the great Isaiah scroll. Let's zoom in. You can see these dots. They mark the word Birushalayim as a mistake. So what happened? Someone proofread this manuscript against another manuscript. In the other manuscript, the word Birushalayim was missing, and so they indicate this discrepancy using the scribal erasure dots. And so the same thing probably happened with the Masoretic text. Somewhere long ago, they proofread the manuscript, their manuscript against another one, found 15 discrepancies, and marked these in their manuscript. It doesn't mean they're necessarily mistakes, but it means these are 15 places in which our Masoretic text differed from another ancient manuscript. So these scribal dots probably existed in the official Hebrew Bible since the first century, or even before the first century CE. Remember, there are no vowel points in these Hebrew scrolls from the first century. So if it is true that Yeshua said not one dot will pass away, Yeshua referred to these scribal dots on 15 words in the Bible, not to the vowel points, because the vowel points did not exist back then. So we have evidence that these specific dots existed on 15 words in the Hebrew Bible from early sources. For example, the Sifrei from the 2nd century, they talk about these nekudot. And they say, or on a far journey, that's a quote from the Bible, there is a nikud above the hay, for even if he is on a nearby journey and is unclean, he must not do the Passover with them. So they're talking about the word rechoka in the Hebrew Bible, and the hay of the word rechoka has a dot above it. It's not a vowel point, it's not a cholam. It's a scribal marker or dot, and this dot existed back in the 2nd century. And there here we have the rabbinical interpretation of this dot. They knew it's kind of an erasure dot, and so they say, well, the words marked with these dots don't really mean what they say. There are many different interpretations, but we can see that these dots existed on the same letters back then than they exist on today in the Masoretic text. Second example here. Between me and you has Nikud above it, because she did not say it to him, but concerning Hagar. Still today, this word, Beinecha, in the Masoretic text, has an Nikud above it. And then they said unto him, where is Sarah your wife? It has an Nikud above it, because they did know where Sarah was. So these same words that are today marked with dots above them were marked with dots above them back in the 2nd century and probably in the 1st century as well. We see these nekudot are mentioned in the Talmud. There are 10 nekudot in the Torah. This is very obvious. They're not saying the whole Torah is pointed. They're saying there are 10 words in the Torah that are pointed with these dots. These are not vowel points. They are, and then they quote a phrase from each of these verses, and I replace this with a reference so you can go look it up in the Masoretic text. These still have dots above them today. To this day. They're in the Masoretic text. There's an example from the Leningrad Codex. We see these dots above certain words in the Torah. They're not vowel points. Here you can see them in the Aleppo Codex. They're not vowel points. These are the dots that existed back in the 1st century and were used even before the 1st century. And so if Yeshua spoke about dots, I really think Yeshua said not one word will pass away, but if Yeshua spoke about dots, these are the dots that existed back in the 1st century. No indication that the vowel points existed back in the 1st century. So we see that Nehemiah Gordon ignores the evidence and he misrepresents what Yeshua said just to get believers in Yeshua to get excited about Nehemiah Gordon and his discovery of the Cholam. Okay, let's talk about evidence from the Talmud. Just about everyone who says that the vowel points are from Moses will quote the Talmud. Here's an example. Statements such as the two above, which are examples in the Talmud saying, do not read it so, but read it so, or the Talmud discussing two different pronunciations of the same word, support the contention that vowels were already extant in the Hebrew text of Scripture at the time of the composition of the Babylonian Talmud. Now, let's look at an actual example of this in the Talmud and see whether these people's argument actually works or not. Is this a valid argument? So we see in the Talmud, for example, and let's read this in Aramaic first. Wa'amar Rabbi Abahu, and Rabbi Abahu says, Al tikrei alei ayin, ela olei ayin. Do not read by a fountain, but ascending above an eye. So in Hebrew, we often have one set of consonants pronounced in different ways, and if you pronounce it in different ways, it gives very different meanings. For example, the word mem, tet, hey can be pronounced as mata, which means downwards, mita, meaning couch or bed, or mate, meaning rod or staff, or even can even mean tribe. So the vowels you place on a word, or the vowels you pronounce a word with, can change the meaning. So what is this supposed to prove? This is supposed to prove that In the Talmudic era, the Bible was fully vowel pointed. Every word was vowel pointed, with vowel points that were divinely inspired and either came from Ezra, Moses, or Adam. Okay? And so the rabbis are saying you can't read these words differently than the way they're pointed. You must stick to the way they're pointed in the Hebrew Bible. This is what these quotes are supposed to prove. However, when we look at the pointed text of the Hebrew Bible and we compare that with what the rabbis in the Talmud say, most of the time these rabbis contradict the biblical text in terms of context, and they also contradict the vowel points in the Hebrew Bible. So when we go to this actual phrase in the Hebrew Bible, it says ale ayin, the way the Talmud says you should not read it. It does not say ole ayin, and that's what the Talmud says you should read. So what's going on here? By the way, you don't need the vowel points to know the meaning. It says bein porat Yosef. A young fruit tree is Joseph. Bein porat ale ayin, a young fruit tree by a fountain. It's rather obvious that fruitful fruit trees grow besides fountains, not above eyes. So you can see that this rabbi's interpretation is very far-fetched, and it's a symbolic interpretation based on the argument that he's engaging in. Okay? And so actually what these phrases prove is that the Bible was not vowel-pointed in the Talmudic era, and this gave the rabbis the freedom to read words the way they wanted to read it. Do you really think that if the Bible was fully vowel pointed with divinely inspired vowels at the time of the rabbis, would they have had the freedom to read it the way they wanted to read it and even tell the other people, don't read it this way, read it that way, contradicting the inspired text? The rabbis would not have done this. We see how that the rabbis in the Talmud were quite meticulous about the biblical text. They actually counted the letters in the Bible, and they said this is the central letter in the Torah. And when they talked about the application of certain rules, they would say this word is spelled with a vowel letter, so it's got five letters instead of four, and so it's got five applications instead of four. So how would they just nullify the vowel points? Where did they get this freedom? They had this freedom because there were no vowel points in the Hebrew Bible back then, and they could read it the way they wanted to read it based on their particular symbolic interpretation. Secondly, we see here in the Talmud how that they add a vowel letter to this word. Don't read ale ayin, read ole ayin. They add a vowel letter wow to this word ale, which now becomes ole. Now, why would they do that if they had vowel points? Like I just said, the rabbis even made laws based on the vowel letters in the Hebrew Bible. Why would they add this vowel letter to a word from the Hebrew Bible if they had vowel points? They could have pointed it with a cholam. If they had names for the vowels, they could have said, don't read ole ayin with chateif patach, read ole ayin with cholam. They couldn't do that. So wherever possible, where they have these different pronunciations in the Talmud, where they can use a vowel letter well, they add it to their text to help you to see the difference between the two pronunciations. At times, there's no good vowel letter to indicate the difference, and then the context in the Talmud clearly shows you what the rabbis were arguing about. Let's look at one more example of this. This is actually quite a famous one. Al tikre banayich ela bonayich. Do not read your children, but your builders. Now, let's just remind ourselves, what is this supposed to prove? Based on the people who believe in the divine inspiration of the vowel points, this is supposed to prove the biblical text back then was pointed. And because the biblical text pointed this word as bonayich, that's why the rabbis say, don't read it bonayich, that's the wrong way, read it bonayich. Exactly the opposite. When we go to the Hebrew Bible, it says banayich. Wechol banayich limudei yodevahei, and all your children will be taught by yodevahei. This rabbi says, don't read it that way. Read all your builders will be taught by Yodevahei. So where did the rabbis get the freedom to read these words differently if they were pointed with vowel points from Moses or Ezra back in the Talmudic era? This would never have happened. Okay, so the rabbis don't confirm the Masoretic text. Most of the time when they say don't read it this way, read it that way, they're contradicting the traditional reading, they're contradicting the contextual reading, and they're contradicting the vowel points in the Hebrew Bible. And again, we see how they added a vowel letter to this word, bonayich. It shows they used vowel letters to indicate special pronunciation, and they would not have liked to do this. They would have tried to avoid this. If they had vowel points, they would simply have placed a cholam above that bait and a comet beneath this bait. Okay? Now, people bring yet other arguments from the Talmud. For example, they say, the Talmud says, the Talmud mentions the signs of the accents. Now, that's true, but the Talmud makes it very clear that the signs of the accents are indicated by the right hand. It never says the signs of the accents were written down into the biblical text. So they had a tradition of reading the Bible, and someone knowing this tradition and knowing where to lower his voice and where to raise his voice would use his right hand to indicate to other people how to read the Bible. It was not written down. People say the Talmud mentions vowels. That's true, but it doesn't mention vowel points. There's a big difference. Ever since the Hebrew language existed, there were vowels because you can't pronounce a word without a vowel. That's true. But you can read Hebrew without vowel points. Even in Israel today, the newspaper, for the most part, has no vowel points. And when people read it out loud, they read with vowels. There's a big difference between vowels and vowel points. Also, people say, no, the Talmud mentions mesorot. Mesorot are handed down traditions. Now, this supposedly refers to the Masoretic notes in the Hebrew Bible. However, when we look at manuscripts from this time period, because there are fragments of Hebrew manuscripts from the 1st century, 2nd century, 3rd century, 4th century, none of these Bible manuscripts are vowel pointed, they don't have accents, they don't have the Masoretic notes we have in Bibles today. So these other people are obviously misinterpreting the information in the Talmud. The Talmud clearly shows us the rabbis had freedom to read words differently because there were no divinely inspired vowel points in the Hebrew Bible back then. Okay, number four. The oldest vowel pointed manuscripts in the world that we know of are from the 6th and 7th centuries. And we're not talking about complete manuscripts, we're talking about fragments. Okay? Have you ever wondered why people make such bold claims as this? The Masoretes created a system of vowel notation during the 8th and 9th centuries CE. Or this one, by an Israeli scholar saying that vowel signs were invented after the Muslim conquests around the year 700 CE. You know why people say this as a fact? Because there are no manuscript fragments with Tiberian pointing that predate the year 700. They don't have these manuscript fragments. The Palestinian and Babylonian system is slightly earlier, with manuscripts going back even to the 6th century. The source of Palestinian pronunciation comprised mostly of manuscripts of Piyutim, poems, and biblical texts written approximately from the 6th and unto the 9th century. There is no claim by any scholar or library across the world for a manuscript that was pointed before the year 500. That's why I show you in my chart that the vowel points were added after the year 500. There are manuscripts from the 4th century, 3rd century, 2nd century, 1st century CE. They don't have vowel points. Certainly if the vowel points existed back then, we would find fragments with vowel points. It's pretty clear. Here's one of the oldest pointed fragments that we know of. Paul Karl said that this manuscript must be older than the year 700 based on the unusual pointing of the word Oshroyer with a cholam rather than a comet. So you can see that's the equivalent of a cholam. That's a cholam in the Palestinian pointing. And so this shows the manuscript was most likely pointed before the year 700. So 7th century, maybe 6th century. Okay, so we're not talking about old manuscripts that were pointed much later. Sometimes you can clearly see in a manuscript the consonants are worn out and old and the vowel points are new and fresh. We're talking about when the vowels were actually written down into the manuscripts. So it's pretty clear. If the vowel points come from Moses or Ezra, Why are there no vowel-pointed manuscript fragments that predate the 6th century? When these people tell us, oh no, the vowel points come from Moses, oh no, the vowel points come from Ezra, or like Nehemiah, Yeshua's words testify to this cholam, is this true? Or is this a lie in the name of Yeshua, a lie in the name of Moses, a lie in the name of Ezra? The evidence is quite obvious. Evidence number 5, there are 3 unique and different systems of vowel pointing. They are the Tiberian pointing, the Babylonian pointing, and the Palestinian pointing. People also talk about the Yemenite pointing, but that's just a special kind or an adapted kind of Babylonian pointing. So these are the 3 original systems. Okay, and let's compare some of these vowel signs. The comet in the Palestinian system is above the line and looks very different than the Babylonian comets, but again, it's above the line. And in the Tiberian system, the comet is below the line. Very different vowel signs, okay? This vowel sign above the line in Palestinian pointing is a chirak. In Babylonian pointing above the line, it's a cholam. In Tiberian pointing, they don't actually show it here because above the line, it's not a vowel point. It is an accent. It's zakev katon. And this sign beneath the line in Tiberian system is a schwa. So can you see these vowel signs are different? The dots are in different shapes. They've got different numbers. Here you use 3 dots for the O. There you use 2 dots for the O. Here we use 1 dot for the O. So is it even possible that not one dot has passed away from the Torah if these dots supposedly refer to the vowel points? How is that possible? How could these 3 different systems be in existence today if the vowel points came from Moses or Ezra? Okay, let's look at real-life examples of these vowel pointing systems. Here is the Babylonian pointing system in the Berlin Codex, and let's look at a close-up. And we're going to compare these 2 phrases and look at the difference in vowel pointing between the Babylonian system and the Tiberian system. Here we have, Beyom Akra Maher Aneni. Answer me speedily in the day when I call. Okay? In Tiberian Hebrew, Beyom Akra Maher Aneni. Answer me speedily in the day when I call. Can you see these vowel points look quite different? Here's a schwa in the Tiberian system. Here's the schwa in the Babylonian system. There's the cholam in the Babylonian system. There's the cholam in the Tiberian system. This one dot above the line in the Babylonian system is a chirak. Completely different systems. And they all come from Ezra or Moses? Really? Okay, something else to consider. This word is pronounced in Babylonian Hebrew as akra, patach, and kamet. Akra. In Tiberian Hebrew, it's pronounced differently. Ekra, with e at the beginning. Sigol, ekra. Can you see there's a slight difference? Why is there this difference? Because Yeshua prophesied and not one of these dots have changed? No, in Babylonian Hebrew, they don't have an e. In the genuine Babylonian manuscripts, they don't have an e. They have a, but an e normally becomes an a. So in Babylon, they said akra. In Tiberias, they said ekra. Can you see here? These vowel points capture the traditional reading as it was actually pronounced in Babylon and as it was actually pronounced in Tiberias. Just keep in mind that both in Babylon and in Tiberias, they pronounce the name as Adonai. That's why we have the same vowels on the name in these different systems in some manuscripts. Okay, so these systems are different. The pronunciation indicated by these 2 systems are sometimes different. Let's look at the Palestinian pointing. We've seen this fragment. Something that's interesting in these Palestinian manuscripts is that not every word is vowel pointed. Here you can see the word Lamnatseach, no vowel points. Al-Macholat, no vowel points. Many of the words in the Palestinian manuscripts are not vowel pointed. So again, do all these points come from Ezra and Moses? We can see the system is still partly developed. Let's look at a close-up and compare here with the Tiberian system. We have here et banayich ve et benoteich asher. Now, can you see here, banayich has only 1 vowel above it, the comets. Ve et has no vowels on it. Ben Oteich is fully vowel pointed with the three vowels, and Asher again has no vowel points on it. So they're helping you with the difficult words. You need to know Hebrew to pronounce this correctly. Okay, you need to know that's et, you need to know that's Asher. But if you know Hebrew, you don't need extra help with vowel points. And so they help you with the difficult words. Now, let's compare this word, Ben Oteich, with the way it's pointed in the Tiberian system. Here it is, Beno Tayich. Can you see we have a patach and a chilek there? Patach and a chilek, Beno Tayich. Whereas in the Palestinian system, it's Beno Teich with a different vowel point there. Why the difference? Not one vowel has passed away from the Torah. Really? Why are these vowels different? Because these are two different pronunciations. In southern Israel, they actually said Benoteich. And in Tiberias, they actually said Benotayich. And these vowel points don't capture the original reading of the Bible. They capture the traditional reading of the Bible as it was actually pronounced in different places across the world. How could these vowels come from Moses or Ezra? Maybe this is another lie in the name of Moses, and another lie in the name of Ezra, and another lie in the name of Yeshua. It's pretty clear we have these three different systems, the dots are different, even the pronunciation indicated here is different between the different systems. And then we're all familiar with the Tiberian pointing, which is very common in thousands of manuscripts. And so how could these three different systems coexist in the Middle Ages? If Ezra added the vowel points to the Hebrew Bible, if Moses added the vowels to the Hebrew Bible, if they were simply copied from the temple scroll, how could that possibly be? Evidence number six, the pointing system is less perfect in older manuscripts. It's partly developed. They improve this for centuries until it is perfect. This is one of the strongest evidences that we have. So let's look at one of the oldest fragments with Babylonian pointing from the Cairo Geniza. And interestingly, you can again see here that most of the words are not pointed. Most of the words don't have vowel points. That is an accent over there. That's an accent. And that's an accent. So most of the words don't have vowel points. Let's zoom in and look at some examples. The first word here, wamimatei. Why is there one vowel point indicated there? Why? Because normally this is wamimata. By the way, in Babylonian Hebrew, they don't say u before a labial, it just says where. So this is where mimate. Normally it's where mimata from a tribe. Now it's where mimate and from the tribe of. It changes the meaning, and you could easily mispronounce this if you don't know the reading tradition. The word Naphtali has no vowel points on it because you don't need help to pronounce it. Where et, no vowel points. And then we have a word here that is fully vowel pointed as Chamon. That's a vowel sign, that's a vowel sign, that's an accent, and that's a Masoretic note. So it's accentuated, it's vowel pointed, it's even got a Masoretic note. Why? Because this word does not occur many times in the Bible. This note says rak, meaning it's the only occurrence of this word in the whole Hebrew Bible. Actually, it occurs once more, but there it's where chamon. And in the Masoretic thinking, chamon and wechamon are two different words, okay? But you definitely need help to pronounce this correctly. Were there no vowel points, how would you know? Is this chamun? Is this chomon? How would you know? So they tell you by their vowel points, this is how we pronounce it by tradition, chamon, okay? Next word, weet, no vowel points. Migrasheha, it's a long word, but still no vowel points. Livnei Merari Hanotarim, no vowel points, just two accents. So very clearly this is an incomplete system. They're only indicating the vowels on some words. They're only indicating some of the vowels. Here only one of the vowels are indicated. So why is this? Because the vowel points come from Moses. The vowel points come from Ezra. The scribes did not have to invent them. No, it's because the scribes had to invent them. And originally, these vowel points simply helped you not to mispronounce the difficult words in the biblical text. Over time, they improved the system. Let's look at another example. In this manuscript fragment, most of the words have vowel points, but still some don't. The word li here has no vowel points. Ata has one vowel indicated and an accent. Lema'an, no vowel points. And then this word, a tuvcha, is fully vowel pointed. And why is that? Because when you just look at those three letters, you'll think it's tov, meaning good, and tuv means goodness. And so by tradition, you shouldn't read tovcha or tovecha, you should read tuvcha. So this word could be pronounced in three or four different ways, and they're telling you by these vowel points, this is tuvcha. Yod Vav Hey often has no vowel points in the Babylonian manuscripts because you don't need help to pronounce the name as Adonai. If you're Jewish, if you have that background, it's just part of their tradition. Al, no vowel points. Remember, the vowel points in the Babylonian system are above the line. So these are vowel points of the next line lower down. Al, no vowel points. Cain is vowel pointed. Why is that? It occurs so many times. Well, sometimes the word Cain in Babylonian pronunciation is pronounced Khan. So they're simply telling you this is not Khan, this is Cain. And so I could go on. Each of these vowels here are to help you not to mispronounce the text, but to read it according to the traditional pronunciation. And so they improved the system over time. By the 9th century, they had a complete system. Okay, maybe before that, but here's an example from the 9th century where they have a complete system, and yet it is a simple system. They have six vowels and a schwa, but they don't have any compound schwas. So this word, me'achol, in the Tiberian pointing, it would have a compound schwa underneath that aleph. Here above the aleph, we have a patach. They have to choose between patach and simple schwa because they had no compound schwa back then, okay? Didn't use it, had not yet invented it. Let's look at other features that are not fully perfected in this system. The silent schwa is not indicated in this manuscript. Can you see there's no vowel sign on that resh? No vowel sign, it's hirchik. And there's no silent schwa on the resh, okay? The sin versus sheen is often not indicated. And even when it's indicated differently than in the Tiberian system. Now, let's look at the name Yod Vav Hey, because you're probably thinking this is a cholam. It's not a cholam up there. Remember, a dot above the line in this system is a chilek, as here in hirchik. Okay, so that's not a cholam. Also, it's not a chilek because it's too big. And so that is just an accent on the name Yod Vav Hey. Okay, dagesh is often not indicated. Here we have the word et, actually it's pronounced at in Babylonian Hebrew. So it closes the syllable. This is a hard pay. That's not a rafe, it's a schwa. So this is pesha'enu with a hard pay, but they don't indicate the dagesh here. Again, sometimes they did, but for the most part, they did not indicate the dagesh. And here we have zahur, and then we have a hard key, but no dagesh indicated in that kaf. So the system is simple. They're still not indicating every detail of the pronunciation. By the 10th century, they had really perfected the system. Here you can see the vowels used in the Petersburg Codex. Now instead of six vowels and a simple schwa, they have 16 vowels and a simple schwa. Can you believe it? They invented 10 new vowel signs that come from Moses. Really? Okay, let's look at some of the differences. Here they indicate a short tere, which is like a compound schwa, like a chatev segol. Short patach, like a compound schwa. They indicate the silent schwa. They indicate rafe as well. Here we have one line. It's both a rafe and a silent schwa. There we have a special kind of patach, and the line above it shows that the following consonant is doubled with a doubling dagesh. They always indicate sin versus sheen, and they always indicate dagesh. So can you see how this system is perfected over hundreds of years? How could this come from Moses? How could this come from Ezra if the scribes in the Middle Ages had to improve this for hundreds of years? Not one of the vowels changed? They certainly changed them. They improved them. They perfected the system for hundreds of years. Okay, let's talk about the Tiberian system. And so we won't pay much attention here to the Palestinian system because it was never perfected, not with the same accuracy as the Babylonian and Tiberian systems. Now, in Tiberian pointing, there are so many thousands of manuscripts It's basically impossible to put them all in chronological order. And also there were different schools, and the different schools had some different rules of pointing. So to keep this simple and straightforward, we're going to look at only two Tiberian manuscripts, and we know exactly who wrote these manuscripts, and we also know more or less when these manuscripts were written. This manuscript on the screen is called the Cairo Codex. It was written by Moshe ben Asher, and then his son, Aaron ben Asher, wrote the Aleppo Codex. Okay, this codex, the Cairo Codex, was written at the end of the 9th century, and the Aleppo Codex was written in the first half, some say in the first quarter of the 10th century. Okay, so we've just got a couple of decades between these two manuscripts. And by the way, some people say this manuscript is not as old as it claims to be, because carbon dating proves it's only 1,000 years old. Well, if you've ever studied carbon dating, you'll know it's not that accurate. When we test carbon dating on things of known age, it's often very inaccurate. So for carbon dating to be 100 years out is no surprise. Scholars like Israel Yevin and Moshe Goshen Gottstein believe that this manuscript was written by Moshe ben Asher. Okay, now let's look at this word. It is ulevarecho, and to bless him. In the Cairo Codex, when we find the root barach, we see here Beit Resh and Kaf are the root letters. When we have this root used as a verb, and the Resh has a vocal schwa on it, Moshe ben Asher, the father, pointed it as a simple schwa. Can you see there? It's a simple schwa. That's how Moshe ben Asher pointed ulevarecho. Okay, how did his son Aaron ben Asher point the exact same word in the exact same passage? Ulevaracho. You pronounce it the same way based on the Masoretic rules of the time, but Aaron ben Asher uses a compound shua here, so it's not ambiguous. You're not wondering, is this a silent shua, is this a vocal shua? He tells you by using a compound shua that it's vocal. So he's being more accurate. He's adding a vowel sign, which his father did not use. And this shows us very clearly that the most respected Masoretic scribe, Aaron ben Asher, did not consider these vowel points as divinely inspired. And he knew that he was simply continuing what his father did, improving the system, being as accurate as possible. And that's why he freely improved the system used by his father. And this is not a random mistake kind of difference between the two manuscripts. This is a repeated difference. We'll just look at one more example of this. Here we have in the Cairo Codex, Vayevarechehu, then he blessed him. And again, we have a simple shwa on the Reish. We go to the exact same passage in his son's manuscript, in Aaron ben Asher's manuscript, and we see Vayevarechehu with a compound shwa. This is the standard difference between the two manuscripts, the standard difference between how Moshe ben Asher pointed his manuscript and how Aaron ben Asher pointed his manuscript. So they were improving the system in the 10th century. Let's look at another example. In the Cairo Codex, when we have the word Yisrael, Israel, and it's preceded by the Lamed preposition, this is how it's pointed, with one dot underneath the Lamed called a Chirek, it's an E, no vowel sign on the Yod, so it's a Chirek Yod, Li, and then we have Lisrael. That's how Moshe ben Asher pointed to Israel, Lisrael, okay? And here's another example of this, Lisrael, one dot on the Lamed, no dots on the Yod. Now, how did his son point the exact same word? The same way or differently? Let's have a look. In the Aleppo Codex, it's Le Yisrael, okay, with a schwa and a chirak. Can you see the dots are different? The dots changed. Even in the 10th century, the dots were still changing. Okay, now we have two dots on the lamed and one dot on the yod, and it's a different system. Now it's less of a contraction. It's not just Le Yisrael, it's Le Yisrael. It's less of a contraction. He's being even more accurate, more precise, more meticulous than his father. So again, why would they need to improve the system up until the 10th century, if Moses wrote the vowels down, if Ezra wrote the vowels down, or if they were copying these vowels from the temple scroll, why would they be improving the system in the 10th century? No ways. It seems this is another lie in the name of Moses when people say, oh no, the vowel points come from Moses. It's not true whatsoever. Let's move on to number 7, euphemistic Ketiv Karei. So we talked about Ketiv Karei in video number 3 in some detail. Ketiv Karei is where the oral tradition, what is pronounced by tradition, disagrees or contradicts the written text. Okay? That's the simple definition of Ketiv Karei. But there are many different reasons for Ketiv Karei. One of the reasons is euphemisms. So, okay, what's written in the text based on the consonants is uva ofalim, and we know the correct pronunciation of this word based on the singular form ofel, which was never replaced with a euphemism. Okay, so we know this should be uva ofalim, and yet when we compare these vowels, they put dummy vowels on this word. Can you see they did not put the true vowels on this word in the main text? What are these vowels in the main text? They're the vowels of the reading tradition, techorim, which they read by tradition, which is a euphemism. They don't read ofalim, hemorrhoids, they read a techorim, boils. Okay? So if you pronounce the word in the text the way it's written with the vowels, uva efolim, that's gibberish, it doesn't exist in Hebrew. So why would Moses write such a confusing word into the Torah? Why would Moses write uva ofalim and point uva techorim? Why would Moses write something that you can't pronounce because it's too crude? What sense does this make? If Moses said techorim, he would have written techorim. If Moses said ofalim, he would have pointed ofalim if he pointed the Bible. So this is clear evidence that the vowel points were only added long after Moses, when the Jews decided techorim is a better word than ofalim. We can't read ofalim, we replace it with techorim. There's no way that Moses could be responsible for these dummy vowels in the Torah. Here's another example. The name Yodewahei with Elohim's vowels. Even Nehemiah Gordon says the name is sometimes pointed with Elohim's vowels. We talk about this in video number 4. So, did Moses speak the name? It's pretty obvious from the internal evidence in the Hebrew Bible that Moses spoke the name. He was sent to Pharaoh, and he had to say to Pharaoh, Yodewahei sent me. Pharaoh used the name Yodewahei. Okay, it was spoken back then. Why would Moses put the dummy vowels of Elohim on the name? And also, if you can somehow convince me that Moses said Elohim rather than Yodewahei, why would he write Yodewahei and point Elohim? Doesn't make any sense. Why would Moses place these dummy vowels on the name? There's no way that these vowel points come from Moses. No way. Evidence number 8. Ketiv Karei, which corrects mistakes. There are some copyist errors in the Masoretic text, but the Masoretes wouldn't correct them. They wouldn't change these consonants. And so that's another clause of Ketiv Karei. And so why do we have these differences? What's written based on the consonants is Ye'ish, but by tradition, they read this, look at the green word in the margin, the word in the green box, they read this as Ye'ush. And can you see this wow looks virtually the same as this yod? This is why these consonants got confused in the first place, because they look so similar. In fact, in some manuscripts, they look exactly the same. So originally, this used to be Ye'ush. But somewhere, the scribes copying the Hebrew Bible got confused between the yod and the waw because they looked the same, or they looked nearly the same, and so they wrote Ye'ish instead of writing Ye'ush. The vowel tradition was not confused because U doesn't really sound like E. You're not going to make that mistake in your oral tradition. And so the oral tradition, Ye'ush, preserves the original reading. Now, please explain, why would Moses write Ye'ish and point Ye'ush? It's rather obvious he didn't do that. Moses wrote Ye'ush. Then the waw was mistaken for a yod. Now, what's the argument? The argument is, you can't have a dot inside a yod in the middle of a word like this, because that dot would be a doubling dagesh, and you can't have a doubling dagesh in a yod unless the preceding consonant has its own vowel, and it does not, and unless the yod has its own vowel, which it has not. So this mistake would never have happened in the Masoretic text if Moses pointed the Hebrew Bible. If Moses originally placed a dot inside the vowel, no scribe would ever have thought it's a yod, because you can't have a yod with a dot inside it unless it has its own vowel. You see, this mistake between vowel and yod would never have occurred if Moses added these vowel points, because the vowel points remove the ambiguity between yod and vowel. Let's look at a similar mistake, and actually it's the opposite here. Originally it was vayalinu, and then it got changed by mistake to vayilonu. Can you see here we have a vowel in the main text, and we have a yod in the margin. They read this vowel as a yod. And again, can you see this yod here looks very similar to the vowel next to it? That's why these yods and vowels got confused. Some yods became vowels, some vowels became yods. Okay? Now, the argument is, this mistake would never have happened if Moses vowel pointed the Torah. If Moses put these vowel points on the word vayalinu, he would have had a yod there originally, okay? But that yod would never have changed to a vowel by mistake, because there would have been no ambiguity. You can't have a chirek here with a vowel as its vowel letter. And you can't have a vowel here closing the syllable unless it has its own vowel sign. And so the scribes would never have been confused. If these vowel points come from Moses, we would never have had this confusion between yod and vowel, because the vowel points remove the ambiguity. So it's pretty clear from these eight evidences that the vowel points in the Hebrew Bible do not come from Moses. And when these Jewish teachers tell us, oh, the vowels come from Moses, they're lying to us in the name of Moses. Just like those other rabbis saying, oh no, what we answer our students come from Moses. Let's move on to number four, evidence that the vowel points are not from Ezra. Now, many of these evidences actually overlap. The first six evidences that I list here that the vowel points are not from Ezra, we've already talked about them. They prove the vowel points are neither from Ezra nor from Moses. But with this number six, Kativ Karei, correcting mistakes, some people say, no, but Ezra corrected the mistakes in the Torah using Kativ Karei. And they try to get around this argument saying, no, the vowel points and Kativ Karei come from Ezra. So let's talk about this evidence again, and we'll see that these same mistakes and the same kind of Kativ Karei actually occurs in the book of Ezra. So here we have Ezra 2 verse 50, and what's written in the text based on the consonants is Me'inim and Nefisim. But by tradition, this is Me'unim and Nefusim. So again, the original Wow year and the original Wow year got changed by mistake to Yods. The exact same thing we just saw in the Torah. So how could Ezra be responsible for these vowel points? If Ezra originally placed a dot there in the original wow, what used to be a wow, no scribe would ever have thought that wow were a yod, because you can't have a yod with a dot inside it unless you have a vowel underneath it and a vowel underneath the preceding consonant. This mistake would never have entered the text if Ezra pointed the Hebrew Bible. Same thing in the next line, Nefusim. The original wow year, if Ezra placed a dot inside it as a shurek, it would never have changed to a yod. The scribes would never have wondered, is this a yod, is this a wow? They would always have known it's a wow, based on Ezra's vowel points. But it's obvious that Ezra did not vowel point his manuscript. He did not vowel point the Hebrew Bible. And so these mistakes happened after the time of Ezra. The scribes got confused between yod and wow. And only after this confusion, after the time of Ezra, they added Kativ Karei and vowel points to the Hebrew Bible. Evidence number seven is another special kind of Kativ Karei that we see in the book of Ezra, in which the Kativ, which is written in the text based on the consonants, preserve an ancient spelling, an ancient pronunciation of the word, and the Kari, what they read by tradition, is the modern or the medieval pronunciation. Okay, so what's written in the text based on the consonants is Lechataya. Can you see there's a yod there? Lechataya. By tradition, they don't read this yod. They don't read it. They read this as Lechata'a. That's the medieval pronunciation. This is the way they pronounce it at the time of Ezra, Lechataya. There are many such examples of yods in the book of Ezra in Aramaic, which are no longer read by tradition because in the Middle Ages they no longer read it that way. So why would Ezra write Lechataya and then he pointed Lechata'a? Why would he do that? It's rather obvious that Ezra still pronounced Lechataya, and these are dummy vowels that were added later after the pronunciation changed and contracted. So these are not the original vowels, these are the traditional, later, medieval vowels. Here's another example. What's written here based on the consonants is Nevi'ah. Let's just read the phrase, Wehit Nabi Haggai Nevi'ah, this is actually Aramaic, then Haggai or Haggai the prophet prophesied. And how did Ezra spell prophet, the prophet? He spelled Nevi'ah with an aleph and a hey at the end of the word. But by tradition, they don't read it that way. They read this Nevi'ah with only an aleph at the end, and now the yod gets doubled. Can you see here there's a doubling dogish in the yod? Why would Ezra write in consonants Nevi'ah and then point with his vowel pointings Nevi'ah, which is the later pronunciation, which we also see in the Targum, which is the Aramaic translation of the Bible? Why do we have ancient spellings in the Hebrew Bible with the medieval vowel points on them? Because the vowel points were only written down in the Middle Ages. Ezra did not place dummy vowels on this word. He pronounced it the ancient way. And so the vowel points very obviously are later than Ezra. Otherwise, this kind of Ketiv Krei would not have occurred either. The last kind of Ketiv Krei we want to talk about is a special case in which the pronunciation indicated by the consonants and the vowels are actually the same, and yet it is evidence that the vowel points did not exist back at the time of Ezra. Let's look at this. The word in the red is pronounced as Wa'esh Kola, so or then I weighed. It's parsed as a kal, while consecutive, first common singular, with a coordinative or a paraguagic hey at the end from the root shakal. Now, most other words with the same parsing would have a simple shua on the second root letter, whereas this word has a compound shua on the second root letter, indicating a peculiar pronunciation. This is not Wa'esh Kela, this is Wa'esh Kola with a short O there. And this is why we also have a wow here. Originally, when Ezra wrote, he placed a wow in this word to indicate this special pronunciation. It's not Wa'esh Kela, it's Wa'esh Kola. Now, what's the argument? The problem is that in the Masoretic, in the Tiberian Masoretic pointing system, you cannot have a compound shua together with a vowel letter. And this wow is a vowel letter. So in the Tiberian system, you can't have that. Now we have a contradiction. Also in the Tiberian system, they wouldn't point this with a full cholam because they didn't want so many full vowels on one word. You can't have that. It has to contract. And so now the precision of the medieval Tiberian system contradicts the grammar used by Ezra, the vowel letter used by Ezra, and this wow becomes a superfluous wow. They write in the margin, Yatir wow, superfluous wow. Why would Ezra write a superfluous wow into his manuscript? It's rather obvious that back then, at the time of Ezra, it was not superfluous. They did not have the vowel points to indicate this special pronunciation, so they used vowel letters instead. And then more than 1,000 years later, when the Masoretes invented this extremely precise system where you can't have a short O with a vowel letter, now the vowel becomes superfluous. If Ezra is the one who added these vowel points to the Hebrew Bible, then there would have been no need to add that superfluous vowel, because you would have had a vowel sign indicating the special pronunciation. In some manuscripts, this is treated as Ketiv Krei, as you can see in this one. Don't read Wa'esh Kola, read Wa'esh Kola. What's the difference? The difference is that the new Masoretic system is too precise for the ancient grammar used by Ezra, where he used the vowel letter. Now the vowel letter and the new precise system with the compound schwa contradict each other, and it results in Kativ Karei. It's really the same pronunciation, it's got the same meaning, but it shows us that Ezra knew nothing about the Tiberian vowel pointing system. He used a vowel letter. Now that you understand the argument, let's look at some other examples, and this is in the book of Nehemiah. But remember, in Hebrew, Ezra and Nehemiah is the same book. And by the way, Ezra and Nehemiah worked side by side in the land of Israel. So if Ezra is responsible for the vowel points, certainly Nehemiah would have known about these vowel points too, wouldn't he? So here we have Ashdodiyot and Ammoniyot, meaning Ashdodites and Ammonites, feminine plural, meaning women. Okay, and we have these vowels indicating the O of Ashdodiyot and the O of Ammoniyot. And then we have these notes in the margin saying Yatir wow, Yatir wow. Superfluous wow, superfluous wow. Why would Nehemiah or Ezra have added these superfluous wows to their manuscripts? Okay, back then it was not superfluous. This wow indicates the O. This is not Ashdodiyot or Ashdodiyot, it's Ashdodiyot. But now in the Masoretic vowel pointing system, we can't have so many full vowels in one word. It's such a long word, you can't have another full vowel there. So they place a short vowel there, a compound schwa, and you can't have a compound schwa next to a vowel letter, so it becomes a superfluous vowel. And so this shows us very clearly, at the time of Ezra and Nehemiah, they knew nothing about the later medieval Tiberian Masoretic pointing system. They used vowel letters, and back then these vowel letters were not superfluous. So it's very clear, Ezra did not add these vowel points we see in the Bible to the text. We would not have had the superfluous vowels. We would not have had ancient spelling with medieval pronunciation. We would not have had the mistake between wow and yod. None of these things would have occurred if Ezra added the vowel points to the Hebrew Bible. So it's very clear. The vowel points don't come from Ezra. The vowel points don't come from Moses. Let's sum up. What did we learn today? To sum up, the vowel points in the Hebrew Bible are not from Moses. Number two, they are not from Ezra. Number three, they did not exist in the first century at the time of Yeshua. Number four, they are not divinely inspired, but they capture the traditional reading of the Hebrew Bible as the Bible was pronounced in different places across the world. Okay, it's very clear. How do we know this? We covered altogether 10 evidences that the vowel points are not from Moses, neither from Ezra, and neither did they exist in the first century. On the other hand, there are Jewish teachers, Karaites, and rabbis who say that the vowel points are from Moses, that the vowel points are divinely inspired. Nehemiah Gordon claims that these vowel points preserve the original pronunciation of the name Yehovah rather than the traditional pronunciation of the name as Adonai. So he seems to believe that the vowels are original. If the vowels are traditional, then this whole thing of the name being Yehovah falls flat. Nehemiah quotes Rabbi Asher Lemuel of Krakow saying, "The vowels received from Sinai." As if he believes the vowels were received from Sinai. But we've seen today that when Jewish teachers need to invoke Moses and Sinai, they are often telling lies in the name of Moses and not the truth. Nehemiah uses Yeshua to supposedly prove the vowel points, to supposedly prove that the name is Yehovah. But he's really misrepresented Yeshua, and he made Yeshua a liar, because now Yeshua talks in the first century about vowel points that did not exist as if they are part of the biblical text. He really makes Yeshua look like a liar, because back in the first century there were no vowel points. The vowel points are not part of the inspired text. Nehemiah claims that the Masoretic medieval origin of the vowel points was only suggested in the 16th century. That is not true at all. There are Jewish sources going all the way back to the 9th century that say the vowel points are not from Moses. And Nehemiah ignores these. Is this ignorance or dishonesty? Did Nehemiah never study the Jewish sources? Did he never study the Bible manuscripts? Did he never study the Dead Sea Scrolls? Did he never study what Nekudah meant in the first century? Or is he purposefully misrepresenting all of this just to make you think that the name is Jehovah and to make you think that he is right? What is the problem? Now that we understand what these vowel points are doing in the Hebrew Bible, they capture the traditional reading, we are ready to talk about the true pronunciation of the Creator's name based on the Masoretic text. You might be surprised that I'm still using the Masoretic text to find the true pronunciation of the Creator's name. Didn't I just say they put Adonai and Elohim's vowels on the name? That's true, but by tradition, shortened forms of the name were not replaced with euphemisms. Genuine contractions of the name that formed in a time when the name was still pronounced is preserved by tradition. For example, Yah as in Hallelujah, Yahu as in Yeshayahu, Yeho as in Yehoshua. And if we have these contracted forms of the name and we can prove that they have their own vowels on them, no dummy vowels, and we combine with that a good knowledge of Hebrew grammar, then we can reconstruct the original pronunciation of the Creator's name without any doubt, without any uncertainty. And that's what we want to start talking about in the next session. Until then, Shalom in Yeshua Mashiach.